In the last video, we talked about bias and the calculation of bias. Now that we know how to calculate imprecision and you know how to calculate inaccuracies, we have a mechanism of finding out how much of total error there is in your analytical system. So in this video, we'll talk about total error. How can we determine if a change is acceptable or not? It is the same slide that I showed to you earlier. Your LJs will alert you to changes in accuracy as well as imprecision. And to understand bias, we have found another way by understanding the true value through mechanisms like peer group data. And once you understand the bias and you can calculate the bias, and once you have both in hand, we can calculate the total error. So this video will talk about the calculation of the total error. So LJ's limitations, it indicates the change in the system and method, but does not fully check the method performance. And total error quantifies the largest variation from the true value and evaluates full method performance. And it's a combination of inaccuracy and imprecision as expressed as in a single number. So we have got both inaccuracy, imprecision here. You have got the bias depicted here. You have got the imprecision depicted here. How will you calculate this entire imprecisions of this dispersion plus this bias, and you compare with what it should have been? That is what we call the calculation of total error. This plus this becomes your total error. Your value should have been clustered here with a certain acceptable amount of dispersion in the target area, but it has moved away from the target area and has developed an unacceptable amount of dispersion. So this entire number can be put down as a single number, and that is what we are talking about in total error calculations. Inaccuracy plus imprecision will add to your total error. So that you need three key numbers here. You are looking at three key numbers here. The observed mean, which is a fact. You have calculated it in your lab. You know what your mean is. And your true value, which is only the best estimate, like the peer group. You've got a very good estimate there. That is your true value. And together, they give the absolute bias, or you call it the systematic error. We already have seen this in the earlier videos. And for as a CV percent is again a fact, that is your dispersion, and that is again will depict your random error. So we will have to now understand how we put all these together to come to a number, which is your total error. Systematic errors are changes. It's a shift in the observed mean value. Recap only. Gradual change is a trend, and an abrupt change is a shift, and trend is a gradual loss in the reliability of the system, and it's a subtle process, and it has to be detected and if possible quantified. And systematic errors, this is recap again from the last video. Bias is equal to true pure lab mean minus true value. It is consistent change in the analytical system, and it has a direction, negative or positive, and whatever the direction is, you have to absolute it by taking away the negative sign away from there. And you have to use it as a positive number for calculation of total error. And percentage bias is calculated as absolute bias divided by true value into 100. After the systematic error calculation and understanding that, we have to understand how to quantify random errors. Any deviation from expected in a random way is considered as random errors. And there is a certain expected and acceptable random error within the defined standard deviations and acceptable standard deviation. And any unexpected change beyond that, and what is unacceptable, reading goes above plus or minus the 3 standard deviation, that has to get quantified as a random error. And these are inconsistent changes in the analytical systems. So random error also needs to be calculated. And the unit from where you would calculate your random error is your standard deviation or your CV percent. Generally, we use a coverage factor to calculate the random error. We use a coverage factor on the standard deviation or the CV percent to find the random error. And why this is so, and these are the coverage factors generally used for at the common multipliers, these are called the Z factors. And generally it is 2 is used for a quick calculations, and 1.96 will capture 97.5% of the errors, and 1.65 is used to capture 95% of the errors. On a practical note, in the calculations of total error, 1.65 is used as the Z factor to capture 95% of the randomness, and this is to be added to the systematic error when you are finding the total error. This is why we use 1.65 as a coverage factor. We already know that if you use 1 SD plus minus, it captures 68% of your randomness, right? This is the rule, that Gaussian, that we have talked about several times. If you use 2 SD, it will capture 95% of the data, right? If you use 1.65, which is in between 1 and 2, so here it is 1 SD and here is 2 SD, if you use 1.65, you capture 90% of the data. So you are now using 1.65, and I've already said we are capturing 95. How is that possible? Here it says 1.65 include 90% of the data. For a 95%, you technically should be using 2, but we are only using 1.65, and there are many reasons why we are using 1.65. This is one, the reason, the basic reason is that when you are calculating your total error, you are already accounting for your bias. Suppose this is your true value or target value, and you are here, this is your mean, and this is your Gaussian. You and your Gaussian, you are sitting here, and there is already this much of bias which is calculated. So your 1.65 on one side will also, this is your 1.65 SDs from here till here. There is a 5% which is left out on one side, and this 5% which is on the other side is already covered under the bias. So you do not need not duplicate it. 1.65 if you use as a coverage factor, which now will account for 95%. Finally, we are excluding only 5% of your errors outside of this total error, and that is an acceptable number. The farthest your points can fall is here, so you are only excluding 5% of your data points, even in the, if there are errors there. So one, generally the formula for calculating random error is 1.65 into your SD or 1.65 into your CV. I hope that concept is clear. I can go back and explain it once again. Why do we use 1.65 as a coverage factor? Because this is your area of 1 SD, which will include 68% of your data. If you take 2 SD here, you know you take 95% of the data. If you use 1.65, which is a number between 1 and 2, that will include 90% of the data. And so that will, if you take 90% of the data, you are going to exclude 5% from here and 5% from here, and that won't be included into your data, which is 90%. However, since you are already including one side of it under your bias in your calculations of your bias, there's no need to duplicate it. So we are technically now excluding only 5% of your data, even if we are using 1.65 as your calculations for your random error. So the farthest elapsed data point may fall under any given circumstances under this Gaussian curve. And if you use 1.96 instead of 1.65, you will finally exclude only 2.5% of your data, but this is not required. It's actually stretching your quality specifications too much. So 1.65 is an adequate number, and it's a practical number, and that's what is used. So total error now we know is systematic error plus random error. Let's see this as an example. So this is your systematic error, which is your lab value minus your true value. This is your bias, and this is your random error, that is your 1.65 into your standard deviation. So together TE plus SC is equal to total error. So let us see a few examples. From now, total error is equal to SC plus RE, where SC is a systematic error or bias calculated by subtracting true or the target mean from the obtained or the observed lab mean, and random error, which is 1.65 coverage factor or Z factor into the standard deviation or the CV. Is that clear? You can look at this once again, and if you go over it once again, you may understand the concepts better. So to recap, Total error is the combined value of both inaccuracy and imprecision. Total error is equal to systematic error plus random error, where the systematic error is also the bias and is calculated by subtracting the true or the target mean from the observed or the lab mean, and the random error is 1.65, which is the Z factor into standard deviation or CV. Now, you can say this total error both in units as well as in percentages. Let's see a couple of examples. So, now we know total error is equal to SE plus RE, TV is equal to absolute bias, these symbols stand for absolute bias, absolute value, plus Z into standard deviation. So, if you translate that like into percentages, percentage TE is equal to percentage systematic error plus percentage random error. That is again percentage absolute bias plus Z into percentage CV. So, that is your random error now is in CV percent and this is in bias percent. Total error can be expressed both as percentages and units. There is a reason that why you need to know both is that while you are calculating all these things like total error, there is a reason behind it. We will talk about it in the next video, and that is where we need to understand why both the unit calculation and the TE calculation is good to have, so that you can compare it with the available databases which are both in units as well as percentages, that we will see in the later video. So, now we are going to look at some examples here. Total error decreases if the systematic error decreases, bias decreases and the mean moves close to the truer value, the total error will decrease. That is one way in which you can decrease your total error. Another way is simple, it is if your random error decreases, imprecision decreases, SD becomes smaller, again your total error will decrease. Both are ways in which you can decrease your total error. Let us look at this examples. There are certain values are given here. You have the lab mean of 180, true value of 200 and standard deviation of 1.5. So, what are the systematic errors, random errors and total error? Systematic error is very simple to calculate. Lab mean minus true value, 180 minus 200 minus 20, you absolute it and you have got a 20, that is your systematic error. And then you calculate your random error, your standard deviation here is 1.5, 1.5 into 1.65, 2.5 is your random error. So, if we are to adding up this plus this is 22.5, that is your total error and you are saying it is U per liter, which is in units. So, you are calculating it in unit, U per liter is your unit. And now, how will you say this in percentages? Let us take the same example and convert it as percentages. You have the true value of 200, the lab mean of 180, standard deviation of 1.5. So, when you calculate, how will you calculate? 180 minus 200, which is minus 20, you make it into an absolute value, which and 20 divided by the true value, which is 200, which will become 10% is your systematic error. And how will you calculate your the random error? This is standard deviation divided by 180, which will give you your CV percent. CV percent into 1.65, that will be your systematic error, and that is your percentage of random error is 1.37. Again, you add the two, you have got a total error of in percentage of 11.37 total error percentage. So, this is how you can calculate both in the units as well as your percentages. Both are important because the purpose of calculating the total error, we will explain in the next video, and then you will understand why we need to know in units as well as in percentages. Another example, there are the lab mean is 85, true value is 90, standard deviation is in 2, U per L, and if you do the in units, the systematic error is 5 and your random error is 3.3 and total is 8.3 unit per liter. The same thing if you do in percentages, this is 5.5% systematic error and 3.88% random error and total error is 9.43%. It's a simple calculation, so I'm not going into details of it. You can verify this on your own. So, some recap, some take home messages from this is that total error is evaluating the combination of errors. Total error combines the bias and imprecision to quantify the largest variation from the true or target value. Total analytic error is a useful metric both to assess the laboratory assay quality and to set goals. It's very important. That is the purpose of your finding your total error. How far are you away from your correct value? You need to know this so that you can set your goals of your laboratory, and this is called quality specifications. We'll talk about quality specifications briefly in the next video. And the common evaluation methods are direct estimation. This is a very important thing. How do you evaluate total error? We have talked about one method. This is an indirect method. There are also direct methods of evaluation of your total error. Take home message here once more is this kind of indirect estimation of your total error by combining the imprecision, that is your SD, and bias through the equation, total analytical error is equal to systematic error or bias plus random error, which is equal to 1.65 into imprecision. This is a very easy method of understanding the total error in the laboratory for each analyte. Total error thus will decrease if the SE component bias decreases or the RE component or standard deviation decreases, and vice versa. It provides a very simple cost-effective method for evaluating performance. That is the end of our video on total error, and I hope the concept is clear. You can read more about the total error in the Labs for Life QC module, or much more information is available in the WISGHART site also. If you need to understand it in depth, please refer to all those sites which give you much more information on these areas.